Okay, this is very preliminary work that we're doing. Everyone on this project, which is all the co-authors, plus all my team, which includes all these people here, and not all of them are able to actually be here, but most of the people here were pictured with G.P. Lee, who's the director of CalIT2. CalIT2 is a research unit on campus that brings together interdisciplinary researchers from the medical school, from all the schools on campuses, engineering, computer science, to work on applied problems and sort of deep problems on computing and those kinds of things in science, interdisciplinary science. And we have the support of CalIT2 on this project we're going to be presenting to you today that my team has been working on. The main collaborators on this particular work we're going to presenting today are Prutha Deshpande, Sean Tauber, Sergio Gago, and Stephanie Chang. And everyone but Sergio is present, so I'll be sending your questions to them when we get into the hairy parts, because you know they're really the brains behind all this stuff, okay? So a quick talk overview. I just want to go through what the important problem is that the database that we're going to be looking at addresses and why it's a useful thing and a valuable thing to look at. That requires me to give a little bit of background for the domain that's under consideration in the data, which is color categorization. I want to give you some discussion about creating a new database using some internet-based procedures, and then talk about features of our research problem that may apply in other domains of internet-based research and how we think our approach could be generalizable. We're going to discuss some modeling of the problem and the development of some appropriate analyses that we've done collaboratively, extending techniques that are out there and being worked on by others, and give you some results of our empirical tests, okay? So what is at the key core of idea of this particular domain that we're going to be talking about in terms of the archive? It's this idea that human beings have concepts, and concepts are represented across linguistic groups. And a really key and important question for cognitive science is the issue of individual concept formation and the sharing and transmission of concepts within and across groups. And I'll just give you this example of kinship terminology, which people are pretty much familiar with. Some of the individuals here in IMBS were the founders of the study of this type of field. And it's just this idea that if you have a kinship structure like this for the Eskimo culture, where you have mother, father, and you have uncles and aunts, and sisters and brothers and cousins, it doesn't have to necessarily be the same in a different culture, but there'll be some similarity just because of the underlying biology of the problem. There'll be some similarity in the actual structure, and there'll be differences in how the concepts of the structure are mapped into the lexicon and the social relations of the societies and so on and so forth. So here, you know, your father's brother is just as likely to be thought of as a father figure, same for the mother. Your nearest cousins are actually thought of as your sisters and brothers. These are just variations in the concept of kinship across different societies, and you see wild variations in this across all different groups. So one thing that's really core to cognitive science is this idea about the ways that concepts are represented across groups and how that is done similarly and differently across groups, different language groups, and what the various ways the concepts vary within individuals, across individuals and language groups. So the domain that is sort of like the classic example for studying this and the one that we study in our research is the concept of how the world's languages map color appearances that we all see in our environments, okay? And the seminal work on this topic was done by Berlin and Kay in 1969 in their classic book, where they did a study of 20 bilingual language groups in the Stanford area, and they came up with a theory that there are actually a limited number of basic color terms, which they describe as the smallest set of simple words with which each speaker can name any color, and those basic color terms are actually what they called universal across many, many languages. So just to give an example, if I show you this sort of Mercator projection of a skin of a color solid, which represents a lot of the colors that are highly saturated in color space, and I ask you to look at a group of subjects that attributes names to these particular color concepts and lexically represents them in their particular language, namely English, then you'll get a representation that looks like this across a group of individuals in the aggregate. And what Berlinicke found is that all the languages that they tested had 11 or fewer basic color words, which correspond to red, yellow, green, blue, orange, purple, pink, brown, gray, black, and white, and glosses of those. And they provided a theory about a sequence by which these languages and these terms and concepts emerge across different societies. Okay. So while we know that there is evidence that color concepts seem to be universal, and this was made popular by Berlinicke and subsequently by other investigators, we still know of instances where different societies have evolved different conventions for color naming. So as opposed to this mapping of concepts onto this space, you might find a mapping like this in a Papua New Guinea culture that speaks a language called Birimno. Or you might find something like this in the Ivory Coast, or this in Kalina in Peru, or this other one in Papua New Guinea, and this one in Panama. So the point is that while we do have some evidence that there is this hierarchy of 11 terms that emerges, there is still the question of why different societies lexically represent things in different ways compared to, you know, maybe the English representation that we're used to. Now, beyond the original study that was done in 1969 by Berlinicke, they followed up with an extensive study called the World Color Survey. And the World Color Survey is a phenomenal research resource. It's been one of the most widely cited databases since it actually was made publicly available around 2003. And it consists of 110 languages, 25 speakers in each. They do a very standardized set of color mapping tasks, which I can go into in detail, but we'll just touch upon some of it in the next few slides. The data collection that they were able to do using Protestant missionaries to collect the data really was gathered in 1980, but the process to digitize the hand-coded materials that were collected in the field took about 23 years. Okay, so it was a long haul, a lot of work, and a lot of very meticulous, expert type of transcription went into the code changing of the handwritten data sheets over to a digital data addressable file that they could then construct a website and make available as a public archive for people to do these investigations of concept formation across languages. And that was the product that they made available to the public, a very valuable site of unembellished ASCII data that really is about as vanilla as you can get as a user interface goes. You download ASCII files. There's some explanation about what the strings of data mean in the data sets, which you can use to then write your own programs to construct investigations of the languages that are there. But the actual archive itself is a very bare bones, let's say. Okay. So even though the book that they wrote on it was published in 2009, even though the data in the archive has been available publicly since 2003, less research than you might expect has actually been done on the data set, given the importance of concept formation across groups. So what's an example of the kind of data that they have in there? Well, I'm going to talk to you about one task in particular, because we present some studies of it in a few slides. It's a task that involves asking subjects to pinpoint in this grid best examples of each root term that they volunteered in a free listing task that was done as a prior task to this. And what you get is data on a coding sheet that looks like this, right? But World Color Survey provides you this vanilla ASCII version of it that doesn't actually have these labeling headers. That's in a separate file. But you can, you know, feed this into your programs and you can do analyses on it. So it's very useful. And you can do some very powerful things with it, like you can plot nice little, contour maps here of focus selections across two different languages. This is actually not WCS data. This is our own data from a project done by Prutha Desponde. And you can get really nice graphs, you can do nice things if you do it on your own. We thought, while the WCS is a really awesome and important, valuable database, we thought, wouldn't it be great to construct a platform with a graphical user interface for empirically investigating and analyzing this kind of data, and put on board the site a bunch of research tools that were model-driven and powerful, so that you could open it up as a research, a collaborative research site for people to actually conduct research on concept formation. So that was something that we wanted to do, and we were actually allowed to do that because we got some funding from a couple funding agencies, and so that's what we're in the process of doing right now. And Nathan, who is in the audience and has a poster discussing some of the details of this that you can see at lunch, is the leader of that part of the wiki that we're developing. But that's not actually what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about another archive that is the one that we're developing the wiki for, and it's one that belonged and was collected by an individual called named Robert McLowery, who was a cognitive anthropologist who was trained at UC Berkeley and actually worked in the World Color Survey for a period of years with Brent Berlin and Paul Kay. The McLowery Archive, if the World Color Survey is valuable, the McLowery Archive is like, wah, you know, it's like valuable, because it's bigger and it has more tasks in it. And I'm talking about standardized tasks. I'm not talking about like, you know, the anthropologist went in and asked some random questions. These are very structured, very well thought out methodologically tests, and asking different kinds of questions of this concept formation issue. When I acquired it from the widow of Robert McLowery, who sadly passed away in 2004 before he was able to make it publicly available to people, it came in the form of two boxes, Xerox boxes, dozen Xerox boxes, which included about 23,000 pages of raw, handwritten ethnographic results of the kind I showed you earlier. Inside the archive is 160 dialects from indigenous Mesoamerican societies, and about 130 additional surveys. We're still doing the inventory, so we're still finding out what's in there, that were collected after the early 1980s by Robert McLowery in regions across Africa, including languages like Zulu and a whole range of indigenous languages, a lot of indigenous languages in Asia, and so on and so forth. And these speakers tended to be monolingual. McLowery, this was part of his dissertation research. He did an analysis of it as his dissertation, didn't publish the raw data, and did another analysis of it to back up a theory that he has about concept formation in 1997. The actual raw data is in boxes, is the way to think of it. So we got it, and we decided we would make the archive public as the WCS was public. The nice part about the Mesoamerican portion of the Robert McLowery archive is that it has features that the WCS doesn't. So just to give you an example, within Oaxaca alone, in this part of Mesoamerica, there's 37 different dialects of different languages, sometimes as many as 9 of the same language, but different dialects from different locations. Guatemala, there's 30 dialects, Mexico City. There is overlap, which is the red dots, with the WCS. So it's interesting because you can now do comparisons, you know, repeated measures across two different surveys. And so because of this diversity of the McLowery archive, we can look at, for example, Chinantec language, and we can ask questions about how these languages change due to diffusion processes, language borrowing, sharing, trade, and things like that over, you know, across different geographically related societies, because we know where the samples came from. And we can see in this cloud of living languages, if we look at just for Chinantec, which is one where there's quite a few languages, we see that there's levels of the dialect represented. There's a highly endangered version, there's a vigorous version, and there's robust version. Yes?
What is the axis?
This is the size of the population. This is the level of endangerment of a language, and that the cloud is all the living languages. So the six dots I have here are just the Chinantec languages that are represented in the McLaury archive to show you that we have diversity in terms of the level of the language to understand how concept formation, complexity, and borrowing across groups sharing information can change depending upon pragmatic variables.
So these are different dialects of the same language?
That's right. And it's deep like that. The archive has multiple examples, not just Chinantec, very Zotil, very a lot of different indigenous languages, okay? But this presents an opportunity to do studies that we don't have in the WCS, where there's just one version of each language represented. And actually, there's more than one version, but they don't tend to be varying in this complexity, okay? So we sought to take this paper archive, which we, of course, spent time converting into, you know, PDF files and JPEG files through scanning and whatnot. And we sought to take the archive and transcribe it into a data accessible format so that we could build this wiki that I talked about earlier. Okay? Now, how do we do that transcription? It's a problem because we don't want to take 23 years to do it, right? Actually, this archive's bigger, so it would take longer if we set a bunch of linguists down and tried to get them to do it. And quite frankly, I don't have that money. So we wanted to use the power of the internet to do this. And that's why I'm here in this internet-based research study, is for the purposes of transcribing this data. And the data is different from some other transcription efforts that you might see on the internet. So if you go to Zooniverse, for example, you'll see lots of, they're not called hits, but lots of projects where the goal is to transcribe diaries of Civil War veterans or records of, you know, slave trade or whatever, handwritten documents. And those are prose documents, you know, that have a structure in terms of the sentences and all that stuff. But this data does not have that kind of structure. It has a different but very uniform structure, which is a plus, and so it lets us approach it in a different sort of way, okay? If we think about what the actual transcription problem is, it's not a general information question problem. So you're not going in and asking someone, please interpret this sentence, which might have semantic meaning, and therefore you can infer from the first four words what the next word might be, given that you have a scrawl in there. It's not that kind of task necessarily. It's a perceptual identification task where you have a reproduction problem. You have to identify handwritten characters or symbols in a standardized template or form and reproduce them with keyboard input. When I first thought about doing this problem a few years ago before I applied to the funding agency, I thought, well, there's two great ways to do this. One would be crowdsourcing, which I knew nothing about, but I had heard about it, and I thought it would be a great way to harness the power of the internet to get people and workers to help me do this. And the other thing that came to mind was optical character recognition, because you know, obviously machine learning algorithms can help you recognize characters that are appearing in text. The problem of doing optical character recognition on handwritten data sheets, when the handwriting varies and there's some complexity, as you're going to see in the representation of the data, was a challenge that we underestimated. We have some progress along those lines, but I'm not going to present those results today because we don't have a solution. We have a partial solution. But there's a possibility that we would use it in tandem with the crowdsourcing. That's not going to be part of what we talk about today. We're going to talk about today the crowdsourcing part. And going back to this example of the data sheet with the focus selection data, where this particular individual that was surveyed obviously picked this as the focus of the category that we would gloss as red, and you know, picked a category over here that we might call blue. You know, there's a lot of diversity going on in what's being done here. The problem is we have to convert this into a data addressable file using, in this talk, crowdsourcing. Okay?
So are those things at the end of the lines, the labels they use?
They would be, yeah. And there's... We're interested in that. We have a dictionary, so I'm only presenting part of the data that's in the archive. But with every subject sheet like this that I'm going to show you, there's a dictionary of terms that they free listed for a random task of all the chips. There's glosses and modifiers and all kinds of stem term analyses in each subject's data sheet. There's focal data, and there's also category denotative range data. So that's just summarizing what's in there. There's quite a bit of information for each individual.
The reason I'm asking is, you know, it's fairly simple if you're just interested in which color they selected, but I've been following, because of my research in Chiapas, I've been following changes in the transcription of Tzotzil for many decades, and there's some particular problems, you know, that I could bring up that might be, relevant if you need the names. That's what I
Yeah, we have the names, but I do want to talk to you about this because I think you could really, you could give us some good.
Yeah.
Okay, another example of a data sheet is this data sheet, which looks rather messy, but it's abbreviations, and we have the key to what these symbols stand for, but it's handwritten abbreviations of the lexicon that was provided and the mapping data that came out of the free list. And we also have to convert this into a data addressable file.
Is that the same thing?
It's a different data set. So,
no, but I mean, is it getting at the same variables, but just in a different form?
This is getting at how are all the chips named. So there's 330 chips in the array. So, and a random presentation of them to each subject. The question is, how are they named? And then you're going to go and look at, you know, for example, the peaks and valleys where you have high consensus and low consensus, okay?
So, but this is aggregating subjects?
This is one individual.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so we have a bunch of individuals, all right? And then we also have that same data in a list format. So there's lots of different formats, and there's lots of different kinds of data, and I'm not even going to show you the denotative range data because we don't have time to even address it. Yeah.
So there are different people that have different writing styles?
Exactly.
It
makes it. Makes it difficult, yeah. Some are better than others. Like, this is fairly legible,
yeah.
Right? That's okay. A nice, clean script. Others are like, whoa, you know. So really, it's the problem that was addressed earlier, yesterday, about reCAPTCHA. So you have I think Sid brought it up. You have, you know, you have addresses, you know, from houses, or you have, suite and apartment and all that stuff. You can machine learn, you know, to do something when it's very clean and uniform. But as soon as you start to have variation on methods of presenting it, then human observers are the best way to do it. But having said that, we had a great deal of success with our Tesseract OCR approaches to the optical character recognition problem. The reason I don't have results to present for the OCR results is because our students got so ambitious, they wanted to go to a deep network learning model like Neuroff, right? And so as soon as they went to that level, they sacrificed an 80% success rate at OCR and went down to something they couldn't even manage. So there is work in this direction that was achieved. We just don't have a solution yet. I keep telling them, I'm happy with a 50% success rate if you can do that with OCR, because then I'll farm the rest off to crowdsourcing, right? But they wanna go like be 98 or something.
And then you present OCR results to the person.
Exactly.
And then they compare.
We have tasks like that. And we have, yeah, we actually did that. So I'm happy you mentioned it. So the point was, you know, and this is our idea, it's not a silver bullet problem. It's a, you know, multidimensional problem where you use, you dovetail OCR with crowdsourcing and get them to work for you together. Yes?
Yeah, having some little experience with tasks.
Right.
And so if you have that information from which language or cultural area the person came from who did the writing, that should somehow be used.
It's a great idea, but we don't even need to do that because we have a formal model that allows us to infer whether it's an I or an L.
Good.
So I'm going to show you that data in a second. Yeah. Okay. So the challenges of our transcription job is to convert this large paper archive into a digital database, and this has to be done using an automated procedure. We're not going to sit around for 23 years and tick off boxes. We need to take into consideration that transcription involves a series of perceptual identification tasks, And the accuracy of the resulting product is of high, is very high importance from our point of view, because once the archive goes live, people are going to be using it for data analysis. We want to make sure that we get the transcription right. So, but we also want to make sure we do it quickly and at a relatively low cost.
Kimberly, yeah. I would add one thing to that list, which is you have to know the history of how a particular language was transcribed. You know, what I was going to just get to be general about Sozil, it was first transcribed by missionaries who were English speaking. Mm-hmm. Then it was transcribed by anthropologists with very primitive computers, which had to use weird symbols. Mm-hmm. Then it was transcribed by anthropologists using, like a simplified set. Now it's being transcribed by the people who actually speak the language, who are bilingual with Spanish, using Spanish terms.
Yeah.
So if you didn't know that the actual, it's not just a visual, a perceptual identification, you also have to understand, I think, the history of the way it was transcribed.
So you're right, but the way that comes to bear in our project is it's a matter of expertise, which we formally model and we quantify. So when you have expertise, ethnolinguistic expertise, even cultural competence in a particular area, then you are more informed to do the transcription. I do want to back up for a minute and say, though, we're not transcribing a language. We're not actually transcribing sentences. We're transcribing a lexicon, which sometimes is only 5 words. So we have that to our advantage because we know that there is a discrete number of possible response options in terms of things having to do with the lexical structures that we expect across different languages, because they're not all the same. For example, Vietnamese uses modifiers much more than English, which uses only stem terms, okay, monolexemic terms. We know those things, right? If we do get an informed linguist as one of our workers on MTurk, then our quantitative method will tell us this is an informed linguist just from their response patterns. So we do recognize that, and we understand that there are peculiarities to each language that need to be kept track of in terms of how the transcription is done. But we think we have a handle on that, and I'd love to talk to you some more about that. Because I think
it would be very simple. The color for the word for green, yosh.
Yeah.
You just have to realize that YOSH is the same as YOX.
Yes.
So
yes. There are many. Yeah. There are many synonyms.
Like it would fall within what you're
planning. Yeah. And we do have a handle on that from previous research.
Can I add something?
Yeah.
But so like a word like that though, so it's almost like that analysis has to be done. Can be done once we get this digitized. But so a word like yosh, it might be represented here as some arbitrary symbol. It could be K or Y, and it's transcribing those into digital format. And that word corresponds, and so it's just getting that digitized. And once that's all digitized, then you can sort of analyze. Okay, well, how did the actual words change over time? Or whatever.
Yeah,
but the digitization problem is different.
Yeah, we're trying to convert symbols that are coded messages, if you will, of the underlying linguistic transcription problem and the structure that you're emphasizing. Correctly, right? So there is a way to do it, and I think if you let us go on and present the results about the experts, you'll see we have a handle on actually tracking who an expert informant is. Okay. So this is a lot of words, but I just want to go through it real quick. Features of our problem that we think are going to apply elsewhere, that is, to problems that have this issue of trying to do economical studies of internet-based larger problems. It's not necessarily a big data problem, but it could apply to big data problems. Are the following, and I want to make a distinction here between a perceptual task and a general information task, because we believe that part of what we're doing in this particular transcription problem is, as Sean said, a character recognition problem at the beginning. Okay, so our task differs from general information surveys or poll opinion data from the point of view of extracting what the actual core data is. We think that response bias is likely to be item-based rather than the usual informant-based type of bias that you see in general information stuff. We're going to touch upon this later in the talk and formalize it. And we expect there might be more than one decision strategy, which may seem odd for a perceptual task, but we'll give you an example of that from our data, okay? In large-scale efforts, there needs to be automated quantification and evaluation of the goodness of the transcribed product, and we have a manner for doing that, we think. We want to minimize response bias by partitioning our task into larger tasks, larger tasks into smaller tasks that are distributed across workers, and brought together to a whole again to give us the proper transcription. And while crowdsourcing makes big data possible, we think the procedures we're going to describe are an intelligent way of data aggregation, like the CCT that Mark talked about yesterday. Mark touched on some of these issues with respect to the use of the mode and the median and the mean in the aggregation of data that's collected this way. We agree with him that there is intelligent ways of doing it, and we think that these underlying math process models could be a real boon and a good contribution to collect smarter data rather than bigger data, okay, and give you an economical approach to do a transcription like this accurately while using the internet still, okay? So this is the project that was funded by the National Science Foundation. Why do we think that these types of underlying formal process models that Mark introduced yesterday will be useful for this idea of this character recognition type of task that we have? Well, the theory comes from, as Mark said yesterday, the Batchelder and Romney test theory without an answer key published in 1988 in Psychometrica, which gives the formal model that tells you how you go into a society, survey information, extract what the shared knowledge is and the underlying cultural truth, in quotes, because it's just what's the most robustly shared information, and extract that information objectively without knowing anything about the society's knowledge base that you're working with. I used this technique back and published a paper with Kim Romney, who's one of the innovators of the method, back in 1990 in the Journal of Quantitative Anthropology, where I used a task that evaluated new characters that could potentially extend the 26 letters of the English alphabet. And I asked subjects of these weird squiggles and these characters, which I have many of that I'm showing you in this psychophysical paradigm, which of these would be good extensions of the 26th set if you were going to add a 27th letter, okay? And people could do this quite easily, and they actually did it according to an underlying cognitive model, which is a whole other line of research, which I don't have time to discuss. But what we found was that using consensus theory to gauge the competence of the informants in these tasks, we were able to distinguish novice undergraduate college students from Adobe typeface designers that were sampled in Menlo, California. And even the model differentiated strategies, perceptual strategies that varied in those two groups when you had kanji kana experts doing the task versus English language typeface designer experts, okay? So this slide is only to make the point that we have evidence that for this kind of task of deciphering characters, and analyzing it using consensus theory, we can pick out expertise, and it has an objectively quantifiable way of being represented. We used, in order to assess empirically this set of issues that I've been talking about with the OCR, the transcription, we used seven different types of tasks which were implemented. The implementation was led and done mostly by Stephanie and Sergio. I'm going to only have an opportunity to talk about this one task, which is the fourth design, because it makes a good set of points that we want to make. The other tasks all give data that support the conclusions that we're going to provide you today. But this particular design has to do with examining the naming range data, which is this data right here. So that map of all those complex types of contours where you have regions where the semantic term that's represented by this CA is this convex set, this set, then you have a set here of HIs and so on. So this has a topology to it, And this is the data we're gonna discuss right now in 2 seconds.
Is that one subject?
That's one subject. All these data sheets I'm showing you is one subject. So there's no aggregate data at this point. Okay. So our cultural consensus theory approach for analyzing this data is to automate the piecewise crowdsourced transcription designs for analysis with cultural consensus theory to derive the correct transcription. Enrich the model. This is new. These are both new innovative approaches to this problem. We're going to enrich the underlying model of dichotomous Bayesian form of CCT, which was published recently by Zita and Batchelder and Royce, to handle an inalternative forced choice type of paradigm that we give our subjects. And we're doing a smarter way of aggregating the data. And at that point, I'm going to turn it over to Sean, because he's the brains behind the modeling stuff, and I want him to explain to you what we've done.
Thanks, Kimberly. Okay, so I'm gonna get into talking about sort of the data from this task and how we've sort of started to approach modeling it. I'm just gonna say this is all really preliminary. So first of all, our collection, we're gonna refer to subjects or participants, but there's two levels here. So first of all, let's not get confused. One, there was the anthropologist that collected this data from a subject, right, who was doing color terms. But now we're running this data through through participants who are basically being presented with this and having to transcribe these letters into digital format.
How many people wrote the original data?
Wrote the original data?
Yeah. How many anthropologists of the original?
A lot.
Some of them did multiple languages, multiple dialects, and sometimes one subject was collected from a valley. So that's why there's something on the order of, 100, 200 types of handwriting styles.
Yeah, and so we're just doing this is a pilot study on a very small subset of data. And sort of the goal here is sort of a initial proof of concept of how can we move forward with sort of aggregating crowdsourced data for this sort of thing. And this is with one language, and then we have all sorts of other languages that are going to be different, and the properties might be slightly different. So basically, with that sheet, something like the sheet that you saw there, that was the task. We collected data from 30 subjects. Mark?
I don't understand the sheet. Can you go back?
Okay.
So basically,
we're having people. Cell B, we're having people transcribe the values from the grid into these boxes. So this is saying, okay, transcribe the value from B25. So that's the top left. The rows are the letters.
What's the nature of the topology? Where does the topology come from?
What do you mean?
The
grid of color squares?
Okay, so
the grid corresponds to that. So they were presented those colors. Yeah, so each square here, each cell corresponds to one of the colors from that color grid, and the value that was given by one subject and recorded by one person for that. Yeah.
Portion of the grid.
That's not the whole grid, but.
And what would the value be? I mean, how do you know what to put in there?
Well, so if I say to you, okay, this is B40. So now, down here would be B40, and I say, type into here what you see there.
Oh, just
and so you type what you see, and I have 30 people do that, or
and so you
proof
would
around
type
this, but.
If you did it, well, capital P, small W, is that?
Yeah, so maybe that's what it looks like.
More basic question. It sounds like, from what Kimberly was saying, there's many different types of data, like some of these grids and some other things.
Yep.
So did you have to just manually say, like, take out a sheet, say, this is a grid sheet, so now we have to feed that into our sort of grid recognition algorithm. Oh, this is another kind of data. Like, there's a pre-processing step that had to happen before this.
Yes.
And so, like, so how is that? Is that automated or is that you guys doing it by eye?
Right now, there's three kinds of data. So we have three groups of data files. And we all know that every single PDF in there is an individual's data for that task that's in that pile. And those are gone through, you know, one by one and looked at. But we've broken it down into small tasks because a grid is giant.
Oh, I understand
it's
that.
330 chips. So we want to break it down into small enter tasks so that they can do it. And even this is larger than we would typically want to enter.
Is it automated or repeatable?
No, yeah, before you get to this step, the categorization, like, you know, you had to say, like, oh, this is a grid. Oh, this is some other kind of data. Oh, this is another kind of data. Is that automated or is that
no,
by you guys
yet.
Putting your eyeballs on it? And
not,
then
by, not yet.
I understand. Thank you.
If you have ideas how to automate it, I'd love to talk to you. That's what you're getting at.
I don't have good ideas.
Okay. We'll talk later.
But if you only have three, you might not have to automate it.
Yeah.
You can make piles, as you said.
Yes.
Yeah. Extracting these different sets into PDFs is not the worst.
It's not
the hardest problem by far.
It's not high priority.
So it takes a bit of time, but once it's done, it's yeah.
Okay.
So. Yeah. Okay. So any more questions about sort of the format of the task here?
So I would only add that we in many of our tasks we varied what we collected, but we did collect confidence sometimes too. So we're going to be saying something about that at the end.
Yeah, and so basically we had, I think, 30 people do this task. So we have, for each of these cells, we have 30 different data points from 30 different people. And just look, I mean, so some of them seem pretty obvious, but maybe some of these aren't. Is that a PO or a PA? Is that an HL or an HI? You might have an opinion, but you could see how someone else might have a different one, right?
Well, if you looked at the whole grid, you'd see that the second is always, I take it back. I thought I had a simple way.
Okay, so these are the results from this task. I'll just quickly explain. So basically, there were 128 cells that had to be transcribed, and so that's the rows. And then there was a whole bunch of response options, and so they're all listed here. And so these were all, so basically we took, so this was free response, right? So basically at the end, we took all the responses that were given, all the unique ones, and they're listed here. There's some that are just garbage, very few, where it's like one person did something that was clearly an error. So we started to remove some of those. But now what you have in each, so basically the rows are of what's its interest. That's a particular transcription. And the colors basically tell you from white being 0 to black being 1, what proportion of respondents picked that column, that response option for that item. Okay, so you can see for a lot of these, so like for, here's ones that are PW, and you can see that everyone basically said the same thing. But there are some where there was not agreement on the subject. So for these ones, so the HI, HL, as I mentioned, and by the way, we're just discarding capital I, we're just making everything lowercase right now just to simplify things. But you can see there's a lot of disagreement, right? A lot of people say HI and a lot of people say HL, and it's pretty close to 50-50. And so what the correct answer is not completely clear just by eyeballing that. And the other thing to note is that disagreement isn't just subjectively arbitrary, right? It has something to do with the stimulus. So HI and HL perceptually are similar, right? I and L are confusable. And so that's where the disagreement comes in. It's not just because people have completely different opinions based on unrelated things to the item.
So another question. So is there a key that went along with this? Let's just say it's truly an L. Let's say magically we know that. Is there a key that says HL equals somewhere?
The key is hand.
Yes.
There's key. The key is handwritten. Yeah. So.
But it sounds like. Here's my question. Do you really care that that says HL, or do you really care that that symbol matches this other symbol in the key?
I mean.
Can you rephrase your question?
So, let's just say hypothetically, we have no idea if that's an HI or an HL, and we'll never know. Okay, but my question is, do you even care? Because all you care about that that symbol matches this other symbol in the key. Whatever those symbols are, I don't care what they are. They could have been squash cockroach. It makes no difference to me.
We have to know, we have to have a way of converting them so that we can examine questions like that. So we have to actually take the entries that are made and put them into a data format so we can look at that.
Another quick problem, the keys are incomplete. So
okay. Well,
they're not.
That's a big problem.
Prutha has a sub. Prutha.
That could not matter for HI, but there are a lot of other words which are actually words. Like, not everything is an abbreviation, and you can't say that we'll have some of them as just abbreviations and some of them as. Like, some of them you need that whole word, but you can't have so, a partial.
Yeah. So this raises another. Yeah, this raises another issue is that when we look at some specific thing like this, there's going to be some sort of idiosyncrasies that are not, we need something that's gonna be a general method that's going to, and we haven't a good idea of what the correct answer is for these, but the problem is there's all this other data where we're not gonna have experts looking at it necessarily, we're not gonna know the correct answers, and we need like a robust method that's gonna transcribe things. And we do have some keys and dictionaries and things, but we had some tasks where we were, oh, let's limit the response options to that, to those keys. But then it was pretty clear that the key was incomplete, or didn't, there were things in the data which clearly didn't correspond to anything in the key, so.
Several variants on the task, and we had good support from the analyses of those data as well. There were all little problems that have to do with these peculiarities of the data set, and that not everything's complete, but this particular example that we're going to give today shows how the modeling and the quantification works.
And here's another thing, just driven by this, is sort of, so the modeling approach we're going to show is sort of this well-established thing that we know, so we have to collect a certain type of data in order to apply it. Now, we could do other sorts of tasks, and we can go along a road more like what Mark was talking about yesterday, where, yeah, it's inspired by CCT maybe originally, but you need, as we go to different types of tasks, we need to develop new models for those things and then test how good are those models. Like, well, we know there's this well-established framework CCT, and we could maybe apply this to transcribing this data. And so this is our first test here. Well, let's collect some data that we could use CCT on in order to get these transcriptions. That said, I mean, all these ideas are good because like you said, we're sort of in the initial stages here, but I gotta keep moving because, so while most of the variation here was on HI and HL in this particular data set, there are the other places where we sort of saw variation among respondents was in situations where there's a bunch of possible words that look similar to one another. Okay, so basically, if subjects are disagreeing, it's because it's sort of the nature of the perception of the characters.
They're all looking at just one transcript. Is that you have 30 people looking at one?
They all did the exact same task.
Exact same task.
Yeah.
It's just one portion of one subject's grid. 30. To break it down into small problem to address.
So you had multiple subjects looking at the
of course.
Yeah.
And so you could compare the results basically.
We do.
Okay.
So we collect all this data and now we have 30 data points for each handwritten character. So now the question is what's the true answer? We could just do something like take the mode. But that's not going to be super useful for like the HIs, HLs, those ones where, you know, it's very close to 50-50 and it's not clear what the correct answer is. So what, like we've already sort of said, we decided we're going to use cultural consensus theory and we're going to use a Bayesian version of that. So this is sort of connected to the idea of using sort of a cognitively inspired model, a model that sort of taps into sort of psychological sort of aspects in order to try to aggregate data, because ultimately this is sort of a behavioral task.
You have all sorts of people look at exactly the same sheet and answer exactly the same questions?
Yes.
Sochi?
What?
Yeah.
Okay, so just briefly what we're gonna do with CCT. So this was called Test Theory Without an Answer Cube by Batchelder and Romney. And basically the idea here is that we have data points, which is the transcriptions given. And this is gonna allow us to infer the shared latent cultural knowledge, or what in our case we're gonna call the true transcription, right? There's a latent true transcription, and we're going to try to infer that from the data using this type of model. And it also allows us to infer things like individual ability, so how good were the subjects, and which is going to allow us to sort of weight their responses, the item difficulty, and also possible response bias, so of the subjects. So these are all parameters of the model. Now a few things. So usually CCT has been applied to true-false data, so basically yes-no, dichotomous data. Other formats have been explored, like continuous data or ordinal rankings. But in sort of the cutting-edge Bayesian framework for CCT, there hasn't really been, to our knowledge, multiple choice or free response. And so that's sort of one novel thing we're doing here, is sort of extending that framework to do that. And also, as far as we know, CCT isn't typically applied to this sort of data, right? Perceptual identification. Kimberly talked about how she did apply to that sort of data a little bit in a previous paper, but this is kind of different than, you know, sort of subjective opinions on a survey or something. Okay, so I'm gonna just sort of show how the multiple choice model differs from the dichotomous model, and I'm gonna show some equations, but I'm just gonna tell you in English quickly sort of the importance behind them. I'm not gonna get into too much. So the observed data are just, in the dichotomous, is just a bunch of true or false responses. But in our multiple choice version, the observed data is a response option, say, one of L response options, right? So that's all the potential answers you saw in our data sheet. So that's the difference in the observed data. Now, the latent parameters that we want to infer, one is the true answer key, the truth behind this, the shared knowledge. So that truth in the dichotomous is again either true or false, right? And again, in ours, it's one of the L response options is the truth. So that's an extension. What's similar here is that so recently these models have used sort of a Roche model to determine that incorporate. So the theta is individual ability of the observers, and so we infer that, and the delta is the difficulty of each of the items, so we infer that. And then basically the DIK here is basically a function of those that says, what's the probability that subject I is going to get item K correct? And so it incorporates that subject I's ability and item K's difficulty, and it gives that probability. So in the dichotomous CCT, the true answer Z, K on item K, and the probability that subject I is going to get item K correct is used to basically figure out what's the probability of the data that they gave, that the data they gave is going to be one. And basically, in short, if the true answer is supposed to be yes, then the probability that they would say yes is that DIK, the probability that they would get the answer correct. Plus they might have some bias, GI, which we're going to infer, towards saying yes. And so even if they don't know it, which 1 minus DIK is the probability that they don't know it, they might still get it right according to the bias that they have, GI. So if they don't have a bias, it's 50-50. There's a 50% chance when they don't know it that they're going to say yes and true anyways and get it correct, right? Yeah, so the difficulty of the item is delta K, and that combines with the ability and goes into this probability that they get the item correct, DIK. I don't think I understand.
This parameter would correspond to the person doing original death. How eligible is this death?
It could. We don't have an explicit model of that. I mean, you can intuitively say, so basically it corresponds to how difficult of an item was this for people to get correct. So, and it's based on whatever we infer the answer, it's based on basically, maybe there's more variation in that item, so it's a more difficult item, something like that. You could intuitively say what's driving it, but we don't actually explicitly have a model of that. Okay, so the multiple choice version is again very similar. Basically, the biggest difference here is we're not just saying what's the probability that their response is one, is true. We're saying what's the probability that the response is J, which is each of the possible response options, right? So for each of the L response options, which were corresponding to index by J, what's the probability that they would have said that? And that corresponds to, if they know it, the probability that they know it, plus, again, if they don't know it, their probability of guessing randomly the true answer, which is based on their bias. But this time, their bias isn't just true or false. They have a distribution. Their bias is a distribution across all possible response options. And so that's why here now G I J is subject I's bias towards responding response option J. And then if the true answer is not J, then the probability that they're going to say that is basically equal to the probability that they don't know the answer, and again, whether they're biased towards saying that response option. Okay, so this sort of extends the dichotomous CCT to being able to handle multiple choice, including a bias over multiple options. But that bias, in this case, we're calling the subject-wise bias, because that's, so in this case, every subject has a bias towards, has a distribution of biases over the possible responses, but that's across all items. And we kind of reasoned that that didn't necessarily make sense in terms of the data that we have, because we didn't think that people were going to have a bias towards a particular item independently of a response independently of the items, but we actually have confusable items, right? So let's say that the true answer here is actually HI. Then if people don't know that it's HI, are they gonna maybe like randomly respond something else? Or is their bias somehow constrained by that item? And we thought that was the case. They're biased more towards saying HL because that's the nature of the item. Or here, they're biased towards saying, if the true answer is CPH, they might be biased towards saying PN if they don't know it's PH, not HI, right? And so we thought the bias should be attached to the items instead of the subject. So the same for all subjects on an item. And so we developed a second model that was the same as the first, except the bias now moved to the items. So in this case, it looks almost the same. It's just you can see the index changed here to K instead of I, because for each item, that item has its own response bias, and that bias is the same across all subjects.
Same thing seems reasonable for the multiple choice too, doesn't
it? Yeah, so this is for the multiple choice.
Multiple choice for content items and test items.
Potentially. I mean, yeah. Okay. So these are results. I'm just going to zoom in and I'm going to explain what's going on here. Okay, just quickly. This is the same as the human data. You had rows correspond to one item, columns are the response options. The different symbols tell you the answer key inferred by three different models. The X's are the mode, the circles are the subject-wise bias model, the triangles are the item-wise subject model. Okay, you can see that there's not a lot of variation here, but up here is sort of where the interesting stuff's happening. And so I want to
point out which are the symbols are awfully small.
He's going to zoom in.
Yeah, sorry, I'll zooming in here, and then I'm just going to point out, okay, so I'm just going to highlight the HIs and the HLs in this case. So on the HIs, so you can see, so going down, these are different items, and you can see the mode is sort of bouncing around, right? So some of them, the X's, the mode is inferring that it's HI, but in other cases is inferring it's HL, and it's inconsistent. It's bouncing back and forth. Whereas the circles, which are the subject-wise bias model, for all these, it's inferring that the correct answer is HI. So it's consistent. And the item-wise model, the triangles, are inferring that for all these items, the answer is HL. And again, you can see the mode is agreeing with one model sometimes, with the other model other times. Now, we happen to know that the correct answer is HL, but we can't really say, we're not comfortable saying, okay, so the itemwise model, this is evidence that the itemwise model is better, because this is one really small subset of data. There's only variation really on a couple of items here. There could be other languages that we do where there's multiple items, where there's confusion, there could be other stuff going on. And so we need some other way of sort of assessing, you know, sort of assessing whether our idea that this itemwise bias is sort of more sensible. Sorry. No, we had that idea, but we haven't got that far on OCR to.
We did use an expert subject, a manual transcription subject individual, and that's going to be discussed in a little bit. So.
Yeah. So. Okay. So, just one thing. One last thing to point out here is the mode is not really behaving sensibly and is not providing a very good answer here. It's bouncing back and forth. We kind of know intuitively if there's an HL or an HI, whatever it is, it's the same throughout the whole grid. And in this case, that's pretty obvious. And the mode is bouncing around. So sometimes it's getting the correct answer, sometimes it's not. And both of the other models seem to be doing something sensible in the sense that they're being consistent across those ambiguous items. They happen to disagree in this case. That might not always be the case, but it's not really, that aspect of it isn't that important. But as I mentioned, we're inferring all the parameters using Bayesian inference here, so I'm going to show you a few posteriors and model predictions, and we're going to sort of get a little bit of a qualitative sense of what the models are doing. So looking at a few posteriors for the subject-wise model, so ignore the bottom right, look at the other ones. These are posteriors for the inferred latent truth, the answer key. In Bayesian inference, the posteriors basically are, you know, our inferred probability that the correct answer after applying Bayesian inference is each of these response options. And it sort of incorporates our prior over those response options, which was uniform. So we had no bias towards thinking any of the ones would be correct. And then basically just the subject's data given the model. And so in all cases, we get basically 100% of posterior samples for one particular response item. So with Bayesian inference, there's certainty on the options. So here it's, you know, so for these. And then we also inferred a bias for each subject, which is a distribution across the response options. So here's just an example for one subject, subject zero. And obviously, this is just three, right? There's 128 of these, okay? And then there's 30 of these, one for each subject. So subject zero, it infers it has a strong bias towards HL. And keep in mind that the two models sort of flip. The correct answer is HI or HL. So in this case, the subject-wise model thinks the correct is HI. And so people who say HL, it's going to infer that they have a bias towards HL because they're getting it incorrect, but they're biased. They're saying HL consistently. So it infers that it has a bias towards HL, this subject, and then sort of a small bias towards everything else, which is just sort of uncertainty that's incorporating our prior. So now I'll look at the same thing for the itemwise model, and then we'll look at the model prediction. So for the itemwise model, we don't have that individual posterior anymore because there are no individual posteriors for bias. So the same thing sort of happens for the answers. The blue shows you our posterior for the answer key, which again, it's 100% for all the answers that it inferred. And then I just plotted on the same graph also the posterior for the bias for each item, okay? Because it also corresponds to items. So that's the gray bar. So that's the bias in responding for that item across all subjects. So basically, if you look at the two together, so in this case for HI and HL, it's saying the correct answer is inferred to be HL, But when people don't get the correct answer, the gray bar sort of shows what it thinks their bias is. So what answers are they going to pick? What are they more likely to pick if they don't get it right? And you can see overwhelmingly it's HI in this case. And also in the other ones, you can see the ones that they're likely to pick, that they're biased towards if they don't get the correct, are also ones that look similar, right? So those are the posteriors. Now, so given those inferred posteriors, we can sort of run the model forwards and see what sort of response patterns do the models predict. So, and this is where you see that the subject-wise bias model is doing something a little weird. So here, this is for three example items again, and the triangles show you the distribution of human responses on those items, and the bars show you the predicted distribution of responses by the model. And you can see that it's getting, so it's the sort of the peak is at what the model thinks is the correct answer. But then the other ones around are based on sort of the biases, right? So it's predicting on this item that a bunch of people are gonna say HL, which is really weird, right? Because it doesn't seem sensible. But the reason is because there was a whole bunch of items like this, right? That were HI, HL, and it inferred that there was a whole bunch of subjects that had this bias towards saying HL. And so it's gonna think that those subjects are gonna have those bias across all items. So whenever they don't know an item, they're gonna say HL, which isn't really sensible, but that's what the model predicts they're gonna do. Whereas the item-wise model down here, it's going to predict that when people don't know the correct answers, they're going to produce answers that are of perceptually similar items, right? So the bias are attached to the items, and you can see that the predictions of the model correspond a little better to the human data. So that's for that task. I'm just going to show this quickly. This is just for a different task. I didn't really set it up, but it didn't infer a strong bias for individuals. And in that case, it just thought individuals would sort of pick randomly among the response options, which again doesn't fit the human data very good in this case. And you can see the item-wise model in this case still does a better job. So just hitting on some discussion points. So we just sort of in an ad hoc way, one of the ideas we have about the benefit of CCT is, you know, it allows us to sort of not collect very much data. We can maybe get sensible answers without having to collect a ton of data from crowdsourcing, which would be great because it's going to be really expensive, right, to transcribe all of this. And so it was suggested to us that, you know, often you can do CCT with maybe 8 participants. We realize that we don't maybe have as much variation, at least in like our test data, and maybe in this case that's you would normally have in data that you would apply CCT to. So Prutha did sort of a quick little analysis just, you know, with our, the question is how small can we get down? We need to do this more rigorously, but she cut it down to sort of 8 participants, and where 4 clearly were picking one option and 4 were picking the other and seeing how the models did. And they sort of gave basically similar results. We need to flesh that a bit more, but that's sort of one thing we want to pursue is the idea that CCT can allow us, this is sort of a generalizable idea, can allow us to do crowdsourcing and collect a lot less data than we might need to with other methods. Because how much data would we need to be confident in the modal response, for example? So I don't have a lot of time left, but just so quickly. So notice we had this bias term. So there's this idea also in cultural consensus theory that there could be multiple subcultures. And I think that's often used, the assumption that there's one subculture is used as a set for assessing how well the model is fitting a lot of the time. And we could allow that, and we think it would look, it would seem like there's 2 cultures, those that pick HI and those that pick HL, for example, in this data. But our intuition is we don't really want that, because we think that there really is only one true answer, and we just want to know what that is. And so instead of sort of doing multiple subcultures, we're sort of modeling that with the bias term. And so we're sort of exploring ways to extend that, but that's sort of where we're at with that right now. We did collect some confidence data, and actually, I'm not showing any analysis of this, but it seemed like the confidence of people actually in this case kind of correlated with the inferred ability of subjects. And you can check out Prutha's poster. She has a bit more info on that. So the second thing is, I sort of showed you a sort of a qualitative comparison of the models. We can obviously do more rigorous quantitative model comparison. We can do cross-validation on this and things like that. And also in terms of the bias, you might be thinking, well, there could still be an individual component to the bias, right? Because sure, the item constrains the possible options that people are biased towards, but that within that, individuals could be individually biased towards one of those or something. That's going to add a lot of extra parameters to the model, but it's just something that seems reasonable, but we haven't incorporated yet. And finally, so the whole goal here is, this is sort of a, our motivation is practical. We want to transcribe this giant data set. We're considering how we can use something like CCT or some sort of model like this in sort of an automated fashion. We're automating crowdsourcing, automating sort of the aggregation and everything. To that end, we're doing this analysis in Python. A lot of times there's packages for CCT for MATLAB and for R, but those are going to be difficult to work with in terms of deploying this on a server and having it run automatically. We're just having those sort of practical considerations as well. Okay, so finally, last slide. So basically, these preliminary results we have suggest that we can use something like CCT with crowdsourcing to maybe come up with reasonable answers as a solution to coming up with a true transcription, and hopefully avoid sort of something that's going to take 20 plus years. But maybe hopefully do this, you know, once we sort of get going with these preliminary things within a couple years, get the whole database transcribed, and also. There's just this idea also we've applied CCT to sort of a different domain than I think it's typically applied to in these perceptual identification tasks. And there's maybe other sorts of, and the idea that by doing that, if it works similarly to the way it does in other more sort of subjective domains, it might allow for, in general, being applied to sort of other similar perceptual sort of things and in a way that allows a lot less data to be collected. Now, that's something we need to explore in more detail, but I think that's sort of a direction that we're looking at. All right, thank you.
I missed the very beginning of the talk, but I'm assuming there was some sort of original purpose for collecting all this data. What was the original purpose for collecting this data?
Which data are you referring to?
Well, the data you're trying to transcribe.
The data that we're transcribing is from an archive that was collected over a several year period that is replaceable because you can't collect that data anymore.
It was collected for a purpose, right?
Yes, that, yeah.
Was that purpose ever achieved?
The data was collected.
That's it? Didn't they collect it?
What did they want to do with it?
What did they do with it?
It's the Berlin and Kay color categorization paradigm.
Yeah, I know. Okay. I guess I'm not...
You missed the first part of the talk, which went over all that.
Yeah,
what's the question about the purpose of the data?
They collected the data without... Did they collect the data without any idea of what they were going to do with it?
No.
So they had an idea of what they were going to do with the data. Did they ever do that?
McLowry wrote a book, as I said, and a dissertation that published analyses of the data. But the data was actually never made available for some of the more sophisticated techniques that have arisen, like k-means clustering and diffusion model analyses that have emerged since and have been applied to the larger database of the World Color Survey and shown to be very useful at coming up with a much, much more informative analysis of concept formation for this domain. So McLowry did the fantastic thing of collecting all this data, which can never be done again, truthfully, and without converting it in the way that we want to do, we won't ever be able to ask all those advanced questions to understand what's in the data.
Okay.
It's only been preliminarily modeled according to his private perspective of Vantage Theory, which is a variant of relativity theory, that's okay. His idea, yeah.
So how, any kind of transcription error that you have, do you expect that there are going to be tons of them? Or do you expect there...
When you say transcription error, do you mean the person recording the data or our process of converting the handwritten data into a data addressable data
either,
point?
Either way, I mean, I'm just wondering whether, I guess, the basis of my question is, even if the data set contains errors, does that matter very much?
If it, we know for looking at the World Color Survey that human handwritten ethnographic data contains recording errors. We know that, okay? Whenever we observe trends, for example, in the World Color Survey data, which is already digitized and analyzed, what we tend to see in the analysis of those data is that the errors that are made are random errors. Sometimes they're systematic, but you can almost figure this out through proper analysis, okay? So when there is an error in the recording of the data, we can predict that from the trends, or it doesn't matter. What it ends up doing is adding random noise to the effect. So at that level, yes, there is recording error in the investigators who wrote the data down. In the question about how we deal with ambiguous transcription results, part of the model that we have assumes that things, you know, that randomness contributes to the distribution of errors that occur in the subject's recognition, the subjects that we are collecting now, the recognition of the characters in the grid, has some randomness to it, but also has this response strategy bias that we're trying to model as part of the consensus theory. So that's the item-wise bias that we're attributing. So if someone screws up on the HI character that this is truly supposed to be and puts HL, they're not likely to put O, okay? Because it's just perceptually, it's not a highly confusable correlate. So we can predict where they're gonna make those confusions. And the model that we have tells us objectively how those confusions come out of the data.
Okay, suppose you, I know we're probably running a little late, but suppose you pick one, whether it's wrong or right. If it's, it could be wrong or it could be right, would it make any difference in the final analyses you want to do with this data?
Yeah, we don't want to do that because we want to get the right data.
If an individual, it doesn't matter. If an individual screws up, it doesn't matter. It's just going to wash out.
It's noise.
The model's just going
to... But we'd like to have the data accurately transcribed and get the cleanest transcription we can.
Let's get another question.
I have a very basic question. So I understand you have all this data. I understand why you want to transcribe it. I guess my question is very simple. It's like, so where in this process are you? So you mentioned, you know, at some point you had done OCR, you got 80%. So are you guys like doing like pilot studies to figure out what the right technique is and then unleash that on the whole thing?
Yeah.
Or are you still trying to come up with a workflow, or have you already done 80% of it? Like, where in this project are you and where are these techniques fitting into this process?
We're at the pilot phase. This is like the data we're working with is it's a tiny subset of the data.
Like you just took one box and started fooling around.
It's not even a box. I mean, it's less than, I mean, it's like, it's one language. It's, yeah, it's very, yeah. And so we're just trying to get some stuff. We're sort of at that point of piloting, trying to get some stuff work. We're mapping out sort of a flow, what we want to do for the whole thing. And some of these tests sort of go into that. We're starting to collect a bit more crowdsourced data now to get more data. And,
can you shed any light on like what the other pilots were, how successful they were, which ones worked, which ones failed? You spoke very well about the modeling part, got it.
Yeah.
You know, so what were the other ones and how did they compare?
So we just collected some more crowdsourced data on some, another task of the same language, and we haven't analyzed it yet. And on like the OCR side, we had sort of some sense we're working on things like, you know, we're working on what can we automate. I don't know, we've had sort of also personnel changes and things like that. So, I'd say we're still pretty early days in terms of prototyping ideas and running pilots and things.
Well, one of the aims of the project is to develop a method. So it's not just, we do want to transcribe the data. We expect to do that within the 3 years of the grant. But we want to actually develop a procedure that is formally based and makes sense from a modeling standpoint. So to do that, there's a big learning curve to figure out what the structure of the data is, what works, what doesn't work, where bias is, where confusions can occur, you know, where random errors crop up, all that stuff are issues that we've sort of vetted with the different paradigms that we've tried. And just to answer your question about what happened with the other tasks, we found it didn't have to be the case that crowdsourcing would work for this or that consensus theory would work as an analysis method, but it turns out that whether we were looking at dichotomous choice types of response options, whether we were looking at fill in the blank, whether we were looking at an alternative forced choice, many of the formats that we tried converged on the answer. This is going to be a promising way of doing this. The question is to go through each different kind of task we looked at and ask ourselves which is optimal for the endpoint solution that we want to arrive at, and does this tell us anything in general about how this approach would work for other types of crowdsourced tasks, like when NASA puts up, you know, celestial data, and the workers, you know, online identify meaningful targets in a random splatter of star clusters, right? And they have tasks like this that analyze satellite data of geographical locations and things like that. Those are perceptual identification tasks that you can have workers crowdsource. And the question is, how do you combine information like that when you get an answer from a subject in sector, you know, A7? There's an important blip in this particular piece of data I'm looking at. So we don't think that anybody has used anything more sophisticated than simple aggregation methods that you see of mode, median, and things like that for stuff like this. Now we may be really naive and not know that, but we do know that in the case of consensus theory, that it gives us a lot of information about who's good at this task, which items are more difficult and confusable by people, and what are the actual answers you get from a task like this, you know, on aggregate by a formal type of approach. So you get a lot more information than just, you know, this is the right answer. And so we like that approach, and we want to suggest that, you know, with proper development, it could generalize, you know, to other types of platforms.
Yeah, so it seems like you're trying to build in generalizability from the ground up.
Yeah, for us and, you know.
Yeah, the other approach is just get your job done and then see what parts generalize.
Sure, we could pay someone to do this. I can send these boxes to a company and they'll do it for me.
Well, we do want to get a
we don't want to do that.
We want a practical thing, but we also have to produce papers and things and we do
There's
some
interesting basic research questions here from our standpoint.
Yeah.
From the modeling standpoint.
I get that.
So, I mean, sure, I could send this. I already have companies I could send this to at the 11th hour if we don't successfully do it, you know. But in the meanwhile, we're discovering, I think innovating some new techniques for use in this area. Now, I could be completely like wrong because I'm so naive about what's going on in internet-based research. But I think, given my superficial survey of the area that I know of, that this is a new way of looking at things.